Hello everyone, welcome to National Defense Institute's Daily Current Affairs. Let us see some of the important current affairs of today. The first one, it is Teacher Eligibility Test, or which is called as TET. So the Education Ministry, okay, which is before Ministry of Human Resource and Development, has extended the validity period of this TET to lifetime from 7 years. This means before that, if a person write TET exam in 2020, only up to 2027 he can use that score to get into job, and this rule has been changed to lifetime. So if a person write in 2020 or 2021, he can use the score throughout his life anytime if he want to join the job with the retrospective effect in the sense from 2011. So people who wrote exam from 2011 can use their TET score throughout their lifetime to join respective education institutions using this TET score. And why this is simple? To encourage and to increase the employing opportunity for the candidates, for to encourage more people to join to write this test. And this TET or the TET or Teacher Eligibility Test is like entrance exam to qualify to be a teacher for class 1 to class 8. So this particular exam has been conducted both by central government as well as the state government. As you can see, most of the states conduct their own TET, even TN government, the education department, school education department conducts this TET exam, and the Ministry of Education, this has entrusted the responsibility of conducting the central teacher eligibility test for all the central government institutions, Kendriya Vidyalaya, Navodaya Vidyalayas, like that. For all this institution, this central teacher eligibility test, CTET, has been the responsibility of conducting this test has been accorded to this CBSE or Central Board of School Education. CBSE conducts the examination for them as well. Next one, it is Clean Energy Ministerial Industrial Deep Decarbonization Initiative. As you can see, India as well as United Kingdom, UK, launched a new program to promote industrial energy efficiency, because industrial sector is one of the main contributor to the greenhouse gas effect and the global warming. To stop that, UK and India joined together for this Clean Energy Ministerial Conference of Industrial Deep Decarbonization Initiative. So it is in the name, Industrial Deep Decarbonization, means reducing the carbon, emission of carbon. This has been initiated in the 12th Chief Energy Ministerial Conference. So this CEMIDDI, the acronym, is a global coalition of public and private organizations to stimulate. So what is their objective? To stimulate the demand for low carbon industrial materials, which means industrial materials which emit less carbon emissions during from their process, from the manufacture towards their use. For example, to find the alternative to steel and cement, because the manufacture of steel and manufacture of cement is one of the dirtiest process. When I say dirtiest, it means throughout the manufacturing process it emits lot of carbon dioxide and lot of methane and other greenhouse gases. So to stop the emission of these greenhouse gases and to bring an alternative for the steel and cement, thereby reducing the global warming. And this is coordinated by United Nations Industrial Development Organization, one of the specialized agency of UNO, and also by UK, India, and additional members include Germany and Canada, all the European country, most of the important European countries. And the other organization include, these are called private organization, Mission Possible Platform, Leadership Group for Industry Transition, and International Renewable Energy Agency, and also the World Bank. So again, why this is it is to tackle carbon intensive construction materials like steel and cement, as I told you. In place of the steel and cement, use eco-friendly methods. For example, for bamboo, use of green materials, eco-brick, green brick, like the eco-friendly construction materials, so that it will reduce the emission of carbon dioxide. Next, you see expert group on fixation of minimum wages and national floor wages. So the Ministry of Labour and Employment has constituted this expert committee under Professor Ajit Mishra to give recommendation on how to fix this minimum wage. So what is minimum wage? Simple. Government, central government or state government, to provide how much minimum wage will be provided to an employee that has been employed in their state. Okay, it is called minimum wage. For example, you can see the current floor wage, okay, which is base, is in 2017 it is 176 rupees per day, which means below 176 rupees you cannot pay a particular employee. A state, once a national floor level minimum wage, as you can see, national floor level minimum wage as mandated by the code of wages by center. Okay, this will be set by center, the minimum amount that should be paid, and the state government can pay even more than that, but they cannot go below than that. For example, if 1000 rupees has been set up by this central government as national floor level minimum wage, yes, and the state government can additionally provide 100 rupees or 200 rupees, and they can give like 1200 rupees or 1100 rupees, but they cannot provide wage below 1000 rupees. They cannot provide 900, they cannot pay them 800 rupees. It has to be minimum 1000, and maximum they can pay whatever the amount they want. As you can see, the center will revise this national floor level minimum wage every year based on the inflation, based on the economic condition, and the state will fix the minimum wages for their regions. But as I told you, it cannot be lower than the floor wage. If the central fixes 1000, they cannot go below 1000, but they can always even give 2000 rupees according to their need and according to their own capability. And the second, see, before itself, Anup Satapathy Committee, before this Ajit Mishra Committee, Anup Satapathy Committee has been formed to give recommendation for the same, and they have told that 376 rupees. But this was unacceptable to the government, and hence they constituted another expert committee. Next one is Devika project. So this Devika project is nothing but, you know, a river training project or a river development project. As you can see, this river is present in this Udhampur in Jammu and Kashmir. So I told you recently Article 370 has been scrapped. So Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh has been provided with lot of infrastructure development, and one such development is this Devika project. This project is started under this National River Conservation Plan, NRCP, in March 2019 at a cost of 190 crore. As you can see, what is this Devika River? The Devika River is also called as Gupta Ganga, because it is considered as a sacred river. In Hinduism, it is considered as a sacred river and considered as a sister of river Ganga, Ganga's sister. So what are the things that have been done under this project? Simple, bathing places and encroachments will be removed, natural water bodies to be restored, and catchment areas will be developed. So all these things will be done along the river course, so that the river can be used and river will be put into use by the local communities. Next one, it is SAGE. Okay, SAGE is an acronym for Senior Care Aging Growth Engine, or the portal is called as SAGE portal. This specific portal has been established by Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, which is called as MOSJE. Why this has been initiated? Because to support the India's elderly person. As you can see, the pandemic, the most suffered people of the pandemic is people who are below 15 years and people who are above 55 or 60 years, elderly and young persons. So this specific portal will be a one-stop access of elderly care products and services. So what are these elderly care products and services? For example, medicines and health services, hospitals, insurance, tourism services, and accommodation services. All this called as elderly services. Okay, so they will provide these areas in health, as I told you, travel, finance, legal, housing, food, and all other services. And they will, this ministry, they will act as a facilitator. So how this they will initiate all these services? By means of encouraging startups to go and provide this kind of services to the elderly persons. As you can see, 100 crore rupees has been assigned for the promotion of silver economy. So what is silver economy? Simple, goods and products which cater to the needs of 60 years and above. It is called as silver economy. Old age, senior citizens. So the products and all other services that has been done on the market related to that, which caters to the needs of senior citizens 60 years and above, it is called as silver economy. So what are all comes under silver economy? Simple, old age homes, health care centers, health hospitals, wellness center, you know, travel centers and accommodation centers, villages, elderly villages used to be set up. So this comes under this silver economy. Next one, it is Operation Sahar Araksha. So recently, you know, in the Sri Lankan coast of Colombo, a ship which is called as MUX Express Pearl. Okay, this ship has been built by China, and it is a new ship. In fact, this ship has got fire, and even though the Indian Coast Guard tried to avert this fire, it cannot be able to, and it finally, you know, yesterday it finally fully it burnt off and it sinked into the bathymetry, or it sinked into the base of the ocean. As you can see, to stop and to clean the harmful chemicals that has been released by this specific burning of ship, the Indian Coast Guard along with the Sri Lankan authorities launched this specific operation which is called Sagar Araksha 2. And using the specialized pollution response vehicle Samudra Prahari of the Indian Coast Guard, the Samudra Prahari is a specialized pollution response vehicle, and other OPV or offshore patrol vessel or OPV or Vajra, they has been in standby to cater to the needs of this particular time. And as you can see, the vessel has got nearly 1486 containers which contains this international maritime dangerous goods. So what are this international maritime dangerous goods? Simple, as you can see, nitric acid, methanol, methyl acetate, sodium hydroxide and polystyrene base, all these things are considered as international maritime dangerous goods. And this specific ship has contained all this, and nitric acid and methyl acetate has been the majority of the chemical that has been spilled into the ocean area around the ship where it got burnt. Next one, it is Hisab Ki Kitab. So this initiative has been launched by this Ministry of Corporate Affairs, which is called MOCA. Why in the sense is this particular initiative consists of series of 6 short films or modules to educate the investor about the pension fund and about the protection fund, about the corporate decisions and about the corporate policy. As you can see, it highlights the importance of budgeting, saving, importance of insurance schemes and various social security schemes of the government to promote. So what is the aim? The aim, it is to promote financial literacy, to know about finance, how to make a budget, okay, what are the insurance schemes available, what are the various social security scheme, to educate people about that, to educate people about financial literacy. This specific program has been created. So this program has been undertaken by this IEPF authority, which is Investor Education and Protection Fund Authority. So this body comes under the Union Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and it is a statutory body. So what is a statutory body? A body which has been created by means of an act. Next one, it is startups. So India has been giving lot of momentum and boost up to the startups entrepreneurship. As you can see, as on June 3, 2021, around 50,000 startup has been recognized as startups by DPIT, Department of Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade, DPIIT. So as you can see, because of this boost up, nearly each state and UT has at least one startup. And the states having greatest number of startups, as you can see, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Delhi, UP and Gujarat. So these states has emergence of largest number of startups, and the maximum startup sector, the sector where startup has been promoted a lot is, first one, it is food processing, product development, apps development and IT consulting, business support services. So these are the areas where the startups has been growing a lot. And as you can see, how the startup has been provided fund. So a startup, a small business, startup is nothing but a small business, okay, with a minimum capital. அதாவது ரொம்ப கம்மியான ஒரு இன்வெஸ்ட்மெண்ட்டில் ஆர் ஒரு முதல்ல ஆரம்பிக்கிற ஒரு சின்ன கம்பெனி, இட் இஸ் கால்ட் அ ஸ்டார்ட் அப். அஸ் யூ கேன் சி, திஸ் ஸ்டார்ட் அப் ஹஸ் பீன் கிவன் லாட் ஆஃப் திஸ் மனி, கேபிட்டல் இன்வெஸ்ட்மெண்ட் ஆர் லோன் பை மீன்ஸ் ஆஃப் திஸ் ஃபண்ட்ஸ் ஆஃப் ஃபண்ட் ஸ்கீம், விச் ஹேஸ் அன் ஓவர்லே அரௌண்ட் 10,000 க்ரோஸ். அண்ட் ஆல்சோ ஸ்டார்ட் அப் இண்டியா சீட் ஃபண்ட் ஸ்கீம் விச் ஹஸ் பீன் எனக்டட் ரீசென்ட்லி, இஸ் ஹேஸ் அன் அவுட்லே ஆஃப் 945 க்ரோஸ். சிம்பிள், யூ ப்ரொவைட் அன் ஐடியா தட் ஐ அம் கோன் ஸ்டார்ட் அ கம்பெனி பை மீன்ஸ் ஆஃப் திஸ் ஸ்பெசிஃபிக் இஃப் த ஐடியா இஸ் வெரி இனோவேட்டிவ் அண்ட் இஃப் யுவர் ஐடியா தே திங்க் தட் யுவர் ஐடியா வில் ஒர்க் அவுட், தே வில் கிவ் யூ லோன். And using the loan, you develop your company, you expand your company. After that, okay, you pay back the loan and it will give you a boost. So if you start a company, you develop yourself and you give lot of employment opportunity to others. So you develop along with them, you take others in your development process. So that is why employment opportunity has also been generated, as well as poverty and standard of living will be increased and poverty will be reduced. So what are the other programs run by this DPIT? You can see National Startup Award, State Ranking Framework, Global VC Summit and Forum, Startup India International Summit. So these are the other programs to boost the startup schemes in India. And SDG Index. So recently, the SDG India Index has been, as you can say, SDG India Index released by NITI Aayog, a recommended advisory group to the Government of India. So what is this SDG Index, which is called Sustainable Development Index? SDG is nothing but Sustainable Development Index. So this index was enacted in 2015 by UN, by UNO. So simple, what are this? Some 17 goals will be there. For example, eliminate poverty, okay, attain gender equality, availability of water resources, research and development. So like that, some 17 goals have been provided by the United Nations organization. This goal has to be achieved by 2030. So 15 years. Similarly, before that, in 2000, MDGs or Millennium Development Goals has been set up to 2015. So from 2000 to 2015, 15 years. So again in 2015, another 15 years, from 2015 to 2030, a set of 17 goals, that is very important, 17 goals has been fixed, and these goals is called as SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals. And to assess our Indian, where our Indian states stand with respect to this particular goals, it is called as SDG India Index. As you can see, the country's overall SDG score out of 100 has been improved by 6 points. So in 2019, it was only 60. But now in 2020-21, it is 66. 6 points has been increased overall, our India's average. Okay, so how this average increase has been seen, you can see the improvement has been driven by goal 6, which is clean water and sanitation, goal 7, affordable and clean energy. Okay, these are all the goals where area where India improved itself, and because of that 6 point has been increased. So you come to the state, which state performed well? As you can see, Kerala retained its position at the top. So Kerala has been retaining the same position for nearly three years, from 2018-19, for nearly 3 years Kerala has retained in the same position. Okay, and as you can see, are at the score of 75, and Tamil Nadu and Himachal Pradesh, both states scoring 72, take the second place. And at the last three, as you can see, Bihar, Jharkhand and Assam were the worst performing state, and which has occupies the last third position. So with respect to Union Territory, Chandigarh, okay, is maintained the top position with having score of 79, even above Kerala, and followed by Delhi with a score of 68. So this is a trend, and once the bureaucrats and once the policy makers and the government know where the stands, first of all, if you have to create a policy or to create a development, you should know where a state lacks and where a state excels. So if you find out that, it will be very easy, and you can create your own policy according to the need, what is need and what we need, and accordingly we can enact our policies. And that's it for today's current affairs, and we will come tomorrow with a set of new and important current affairs. Thank you.